It's outrageous. It's out of time. It's excessive. It's larger than life. It's relentless. Flashbacking.
Welcome to this special episode of Relentless Flashbacking. This is your misogynistic host, Joey Cruel, and tonight I'll talk about 12 obscure things about Back to the Future. Drew Struzan is the famous illustrator behind the three posters, but he's also behind the posters of a lot of your favorite movies. Adventures in Babysitting, Better Off Dead, Big Trouble in Little China, Blade Runner, E.T., The Goonies, all the Indiana Jones movies, Lady Hawk, Masters of the Universe, The Thing, just to name a few. He's famous also for two iconic album covers, Sabbath Bloody Sabbath by Black Sabbath and Welcome to My Nightmare by Alice Cooper. He worked also behind the scenes in The Lost World, Jurassic Park, where he drawn the fake King Lear poster with Schwarzenegger, a nod to the fake Hamlet trailer in the Last Action Hero movie, and in the lame movie The Mist, where the poster artist David Drayton, the main character, is seen painting a movie poster for an upcoming film. Of course, the real artist is Drew, with a picture that is clearly the gunslinger from the Stephen King saga The Dark Tower. A collection of other original Drew works can be also seen in the Drayton Room. Of course, in the 90s, with the advent of computers and digital manipulation of pictures used to create poster art, Struzan was affected by the decline of traditional illustrated poster art.
I'll tell you something, I hated the 90s.
90s fucking sucked.
90s fucking sucked.
In 2013, it was celebrated in the documentary Drew, the man behind the poster, that is a must-watch. What can surprise is that the iconic poster for Back to the Future was chosen among not two or three, but dozen proposals. And as much I prefer the original poster, these ones are radical too. Even little things in Back to the Future have a fascinating backstory. On the Marty's skateboard, we can see two brands, Valterra and Madrid. Madrid is a legendary brand of skateboards, proudly made in USA. Everything started back in 1976 in Southern California and is still going strong today. Valterra is a leading brand for RV parts. Yes, you understood it right. Parts for RVs like toilets or gate valves, wherever they are. So why in the world there is this brand on a skateboard? Between 1971 and 1981, Valterra produced also, I don't know why, the famous banana boards, the plastic skateboards. So in 1984, when it was time to produce again skateboards, Valterra joined forces with Madrid and the iconic splattered skateboard was born. Some years ago they sold again the Valterra Madrid skateboard, but of course the price was not affordable at all. In the 2015 Hail Valley, in the alley near the Blast from the Past, there is an outlandish poster that advertises US Air flights to Vietnam. Just for this location, there are so many things to say. Let's start with the Allegheny Airlines, that was founded in 1939 and changed its name to US Air after 40 years in 1979. But what happened in 1989 when Back to the Future Part 2 was released? They changed the logo into something really plain and boring. But wait, in 1997 they changed the name again in US Airways and they ceased the operations in 2015. What a freaking coincidence! Vietnam was chosen as a destination because in 1985 it was still a forbidden zone. So there is a nod to the famous surf scene in the 1979 movie Apocalypse Now, and of course to the cursed war in Vietnam that ended exactly 10 years before the 1985, in 1975. But there is more. If we take a look around in the same alley, we can spot a lot of rusty surf surfboards stickers. A company established in 1985 that still exists. If you want to surf in Vietnam, you know where to buy the right board. And now let me speculate about the Surf in Vietnam poster. Sacred Reich is an essential thrash metal band from Phoenix that was founded, guess when, in 1985. In 1988, they released Surf Nicaragua, a must-have, and doing so, they connected the surf to another dirty military operation. Don't you think that maybe somebody took inspiration from this title? We all know the fabulous Mr. Fusion, a gizmo that allows you to have energy from trash and that you can apply to your car. Well, did you know how they built it? Not in a fancy and expensive way as you may think. They just customized a coffee grinder. Yes, a Krups coffee grinder model 223. Krups was founded in 1846 and still produces coffee-related products today. Did you see how the little porthole was it then? There were even a yellow and orange variants, but of course right now the white ones are rare as hell, since all the rabid Back to the Future fans bore them to dismember them. But don't think that the colored coffee grinders aren't expensive. So as I said, every little thing in Back to the Future is special. We all have tattooed on our minds the Black Panthers of the Clock Tower, two wonderful and powerful black sculptures. What it will surprise you is that they weren't created for Back to the Future, but they are reused props from the exceptionally bad movie Cat People, released in 1982. This flick is an awful remake of the movie with the same name, released 4 years before, in 1942. That's one of the best horror movie ever. A scaled-down version of the Panthers was sold by Hot Shot Toys, but the price was, as always, totally bogus. Don't you think that it would be totally bodacious to sell a couple of Panthers, which could be also used as bookends, for just $40? When Marty goes back in 1955 at the Luz Cafe, asks for two soft drinks that weren't released yet, Tab and Pepsi Free. Let's take a glimpse at the Cola War. In 1958, Royal Crown Cola introduced the first Diet Cola, Diet Right. Then Coca-Cola wanted to answer back, but without creating a variant of the original Coke. So in 1963, Tab was launched and gained such cult following that wasn't discontinued in 1982, when Coca-Cola finally released the Diet Coke. So Coca-Cola created a self-competitive product that started to cannibalize the Tab space, so much that in 2020 the bogus decision was just taken. Tab will be discontinued. As always, thank you, Dystopian Age! Finally, also Pepsi joined the Diet Cola trend with the Diet Pepsi, introduced in 1964. But in 1982, they introduced the first caffeine-free cola, Pepsi Free, and immediately Coca-Cola answered back in 1983 with the caffeine-free cola. So Tab and Pepsi aren't the same product, but you can understand that caffeine-free cola couldn't be misunderstood as Tab, and the same can be said about the Diet Pepsi. So these two soft drinks were wisely chosen. Marty Drurus on that sleek black Toyota truck, there is something that we notice on it. A banner that says another custom 4x4 for Staedtler Toyota. That truck was the fourth generation of the Hilux that debuted in 1983 and it will last until 1988. Of course, it says custom because the Toyota Hilux SR5 Extra Cab didn't come out of the factory like that. It's pretty plain without the customization. But not everybody notices it. that the Staedtler Toyota is really near this scene. You can see it near the theater. What makes Back to the Future so special is the attention to all the details. Because when Marty goes back in 1855, there is already a Staedtler, but he's selling horses. In 1955, instead, he's selling Studebakers. And in 2015, there is a Pontiac dealership, but without the name Staedtler. These aren't random choices as you may think. For the 1955, to give this feeling of a gone-by era, completely different from 1985, they chose Studebaker, a glorious brand that closed down in 1967, and in 1953 was already in turmoil and was bought by Packard, another ill-fated glorious brand that died in 1958. So you can feel more stranded, because in the 80s, Studebakers weren't produced anymore.
In the 80s, they feared that Japan would economically rule and conquer the USA.
Check for example the 1986 movie Gung-Ho, directed by Ron Howard, or the little-known movie with the Nakatomi Plaza. So it's clear that Toyota was the right brand to substitute a defunct American brand.
So why there is a Pontiac dealership in the 2015 scene?
I have a theory. The first thing to do is to observe the cars in the 2015 scenes. We can see 70s cars like a 1976 BMW E24 or a 1972 Citroën D Special. We can see 80s cars like a 1987 Jeep Wrangler. We can also see cars made for movies. And among them, you can recognize the star car from the 1984 movie The Last Starfighter. Moreover, we can see some concept cars, and two of them were produced by Pontiac: the Pursuit, revealed in 1987, and the Banshee 4th, revealed in 1988.
These cars were futuristic not only in the design.
Let me digress a little. Did you notice that there aren't SUVs in the 2015 scenes? For sure, in 1989, one of the most senseless car trends that began in 1997 wasn't predictable at all.
Must have been dark times, those 90s.
Going back to Pontiac, in the late 80s, for this brand, there weren't only these concept cars. Despite having in its lineup a Daewoo shamefully named Le Mans, the rest of the lineup includes totally radical cars like the Firebird, the Fiero, and the Grand Prix, so it was like the future of Pontiac was really bright.
But in the real 2015, Pontiac was already dead since 2010, because already in the 90s, Pontiac was in deep trouble. As always, thank you, dystopian age. But wait, because there is another Back to the Future Pontiac connection.
If you read in the credits, Marty McFly is the singer in the song Johnny B. Goode, so we just assumed that was Michael J. Fox that was singing. The real singer is Mark Campbell,
that has a long list of collaborations, and among them, he recorded a song, Ride Pontiac Ride, along with Alana Miles, for one of the most bodacious commercial ever. The 1988 commercial was for Pontiac, of course, and he got even a freaking radical name, Night Riders.
You feel the motion, the fever is high. You got a notion, you're gonna fly. You feel excitement, riding body. Yeah.
commercial, the first part ends. If you want to discover the source of the section weird titles, I created a playlist and you can find the link in the description below. Please subscribe to Relentless Flashbacking so you will not miss the second part. And follow the show on Facebook, Instagram and Twitter. Relentless Flashbacking is easy to find because the name is unique all over the web. If you want to give your support, please visit Patreon. And you can support this channel also buying these totally awesome t-shirts. See you with the next episode. Over and out.